Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Margaret Brennan of CBS News. Thank you for coming here for this working lunch at Council on Foreign Relations. And of course, you all know this is why you're here. Mr. Ash Carter, former Defense Secretary. And we will have this conversation for about 30 minutes or so and then open it up to questions from all of you. So take your notes, keep thinking of questions, and that will come to you in a bit. I do want to tell you that during the Q&A portion later on, and I'll remind you of this at the time, this will be on the record. So, Secretary Carter, good to see you.
Thank you, Margaret. Appreciate you doing this.
Congratulations on the book. I was saying when we were chatting backstage, the last time I interviewed you, we were on some kind of vessel off Estonia when you were carrying out some kind of military buildup to respond to Russia.
Exactly. We were in Tallinn. It was an amphib. And the reason it was part of the what I thought was sadly necessary after a quarter century of, we didn't have a war plan for Russia for a quarter century. It's kind of interesting to reflect on. After all the war plans during the Cold War, what I started, that I worked on, conventional and nuclear, then at the end of the Soviet Union, we didn't do that anymore for about 25 years. And then it became apparent to me, whatever, 6 years ago or so, that we needed a war plan. That's when we began positioning forces in different ways in Europe. But the particular reason to go to Tallinn at that time, and you may remember this, was because that was going to be the location for a new cybersecurity center for NATO. And why Tallinn? Two reasons. One is it's the epicenter of hybrid warfare, of the Russians sort of trying to blur the line between war and peace and do little green men and cyber attacks and so forth.
This was right after Ukraine.
Yes. So for the Estonians, they know what the playbook is for them in the Russian mind. But the other thing is, Estonia is more advanced than the United States, and because it leapfrogged a technological era. I remember one of the guys I worked with, who was in the Estonian government, saying, "You know, it's so strange. I was a student. I went as a student to the United States. You guys had these things called checkbooks. I'd never seen a checkbook because they went right from the ruble to electronic funds transfers, and you'd never seen a checkbook before. So they're actually a tiny little country, quite advanced. So those were the two reasons why they were the cybersecurity center, and that was the reason I was there in that year, and a great bunch of Marines on board an amphib vessel, which is a whole other story. What do they do at Tallinn?
Well, I want to get to all those themes because you kind of knit nicely together some of the geopolitics, but some of the thinking as well about trying to modernize the U.S. military. Mm-hmm. But let's talk a little bit about the book itself. You refer to it on the title, Inside the Five-Sided Box of the Pentagon. And you say this isn't a memoir. It is a sort of user's manual.
Yeah, and it says user's manual is exactly right, executive guide.
So who do you want to be using this user's manual right now? Do you have suggested readers?
I do. Well, I mean, first of all, I hope it renews a reader's, a general citizen's appreciation for the wonderful institution that defends them and takes them inside. I don't know if you all are like this, but I like to read nonfiction, and I like to read about a place I've never been or never will be, and that takes me there and tells me how it works. And if you're curious about this thing across the river and you want to know how fighter aircraft are bought or how troops are recruited or how $750 billion is spent or war plans are drawn up or wars are conducted, it's that. Now, the Washington audience will know at least parts of that already from your own experience, but probably not all of it. I just happen to have been every corner of the place over the course of 37 years. So there's that. For a CEO, it's the largest organization in the world. Mm-hmm. So for anybody who runs something may be interested in what it feels like to run the largest place in the world. In fact, I like to say it's larger than you take Amazon, UPS, McDonald's, Target, and GE combined. More R&D than Microsoft, Apple, and Google combined. As much real property, our real property, if you put it all together, would be the state of Pennsylvania. So it is the largest enterprise on earth. And getting your mind around the management of that, which I did as the CEO, but also the COO and the weapons buyer, I just think anybody who has to run something, and we all do, even if it's just ourselves, it's a management guide for another manager. And then I hope it's an inspiration to younger people. I really care. A lot of people come to me now, and they may come to you also, Margaret, and say, you know, I'm thinking about public service, but I don't like everything I see, and, you know, people screaming mm-hmm. at each other and so forth. And, you know, it's hard to counsel young people, but I'm a fervent believer in recruiting, you know, that there's got to be another generation for all of us here who care about the country, care about the world, care about our values, and carry on this whole project. And what I tell them is, it's the only government we got. Mm-hmm. And when I joined in the 1980s, I didn't love everything that was happening either. But it's the only government we got. You can't go down the street and shop for another one. It's it. So if you don't like it, get in the game.
So what happens, I mean, given the scope of what you just described, when you have the level of turnover at the top that we have seen over the past few months at the Pentagon, and when you don't have someone who is confirmed by Congress in that role, what does that do to the executive?
Well, it's not good. And here, I'll give you it in a kind of good news, bad news way, Margaret. The good news is the Department of Defense is, relatively speaking, a place with a very strong compass or a deep keel. You remember, you got 2.8 million professionals there, essentially, civilian and military, and a place that responds very well to good order and discipline and will kind of, so it'll kind of hold together. That's fine. But no organization, and it's maybe even especially including the Department of Defense, because clarity and consistency and order are so important to it, can move forward without a leader. So what bothers me isn't that the place is going to fall apart, or that we're going to, you know, get in a position where we can't win wars anymore or anything like that. But we've got to keep moving, because it's a competitive world out there. The Chinese, the Russians, the Iranians, the North Koreans, terrorists. And if you're going to stay the best, you have to have a really competitive streak. And you got to stay the best in people, and we've got labor markets now that are challenging for us. You got to stay the best in technology, and that kind, and only the secretary and the top leadership can move people forward. They'll keep doing whatever they're doing well, probably for a long time, although I hope it didn't take that long, but they're not going to move forward. That's where the problem comes.
And not having someone who has the sort of ability to say, I am Senate confirmed, that I am here and I have the vision. How much does that impact?
Unfortunately, that's kind of like half the battle. The other half is going to be, and the president listens to me.
Right.
And that, I didn't have to deal with that, and none of my predecessors in my observation did. I mean, when I first worked for Weinberger, for example, it was quite clear that President Reagan listened to Caspar Weinberger. That didn't mean that Caspar Weinberger won all the interagency battles and stuff like that, but he was always listening to it. I always knew that my boss, and at that time he was my boss, but it was plain as day that the President of the United States listened to the head of the Department of Defense. And I, you know, same thing with Bush 1, Dick Cheney, Bill Perry, and Bill Clinton, on and on and on, it, through President Obama. And mm-hmm. and I did I win everything with President Obama? Most of the time, yes, but not every time. But I always got a shot. And he was very, very respectful listener. In fact, sometimes irritatingly so, when he was listening to somebody else. He'd say, okay, Mr. President, you know, you wanted to say, they've had their turn, they said their piece, you don't have to wait. He was extremely polite about listening to people. And, you know, it's not clear that President Trump listens or is going to listen to his Secretary of Defense. That's a bigger problem than just for the Secretary of Defense. But one of the things, that there's a passage in the book where I talk about the question of whether you take a job when you're offered a job. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people say, well, the President of the United States calls you up. The answer is only one answer. The answer is yes. I think that's false. You have to think about it a little bit. You have to say to yourself, can I help this person succeed? That's what it's all about. And of course, you have to be true to your values as well. Those are the two things you have to do. But I wouldn't know how to help this president because he doesn't seem to listen to his Secretary of Defense. So that's going to be the other trick for somebody new. They may get Senate confirmed, and they may be able to hold the department together, and that's a good thing. But somehow they have to establish a rapport with the president. Otherwise, that all the value of the Defense Department, it's a fantastic place, and it's got a lot to say about the world, and a huge reservoir of expertise and knowledge. Not to be able to bring that to bear on the President of the United States, that would be really frustrating to me.
And you don't see the current National Security Advisor running regular consultations or meetings or some of the process that you...
This is the outside looking in, Margaret, but I think there's a process, but it's kind of not connected to the president, mm-hmm. is what I infer from reading the... But that's, again, from the outside looking in. John Bolton, whom I've known through all those administrations that he served, certainly knows how the NSC ran, for example, under Brent Scowcroft, who invented the current system, which is a great system. And so I would imagine he knows how to do those meetings. But he's got the same problem the Secretary of Defense does, which is, are you hitched to the man at the top or not? And it doesn't seem to me he has either. Is closely hitched to the president, and that's got to be frustrating also.
So let's talk a little bit about geopolitics. Okay. We started with Russia and the threats you were trying to position for at the time. Where are we now in terms of Russia as a strategic challenge to
it's
the
a
United
big
States?
Problem.
And do you feel like you left the U.S. in a position where it could actually push back?
Yeah, I mean, it's not wonderful to have war as your the thing that you're thinking about. But the reason you think about war is so that they know that if they start something with us, they're going to lose and we're going to win.
And you've said Vladimir Putin was not adequately deterred and continues not to be adequately deterred.
Yeah, I mean, take a look at people say, did we do enough after the 2016 election? Hacking the Obama administration or the Trump administration, the answer is plain as day, no. And I said, if you want evidence of that, look at Vladimir Putin. Does this look like a man who has been chastised? I mean, the question answers itself. He's someone that I've known since 1993, when he used to take notes in the back of summits between Clinton and Yeltsin. He's been around a long time, and he is a considerable geostrategic thinker. I mean, Vladimir Putin, I can't agree with everything he says, but he doesn't make any, there's no mystery about it. Mm-hmm. He speaks extremely well. He writes extremely well. He says exactly what he means. And people are always saying to me, what do you think Putin's thinking? I said, well, I know exactly what Putin's thinking. He just said what he's thinking. But one of the things he's thinking is that he wants to screw my country. And that's the, you know, everything else, we can talk about Syria, we can talk about terrorism, we can talk about, Eastern Europe, NATO enlargement, whatever he wants to talk about, that's arms control. These are important things to talk, and I know how to talk to people you don't get along with. You agree where you can, you agree to disagree where you can't, and that's, that's diplomatic life. That's okay, but when one of the guy's intentions is to thwart you, it's a little, then you start to say to yourself, well, where's the middle ground between,
right.
Is it half thwarting me? Or it's so that's what makes it so difficult to deal with Vladimir. But he's there. He's not going anywhere for a while. And I think the Russians and the Chinese are the same way, almost everybody. They do respond to pressure. He does respond to counter pressure. It's a mistake to let him run wild.
So when you hear now from the Trump administration that they're interested in either exiting certain agreements like the INF treaty, which is about to happen, or reconsidering things like New START, limits on warheads, and then maybe bringing the Chinese into three-party talks to come up with a new weapons deal, knitting together those two challengers to the United States. What do you think about that? I mean, is that just wishful thinking? Is that a feint because it'll never get done anyway?
It'll never get done anyway. So the second one is easier because there's no logic to that at all. They both can play that, play us in that game. And so why would you get in a room with two parties who are going to be very good at playing a democracy that is, I mean, and now at the same time, they're not going to get along. This idea that the Russians and the Chinese are going to gang up on the Americans, I've never actually believed in that. Because they don't have any other interests. Russia's going like this. China's going like this. And they're going to be at each other a little bit in the Far East. And they have almost nothing in common except that they both don't like us.
Right.
That's the only thing they have. That's not enough, to make a condominium out of. With respect to the first thing, though, I think it's more serious. We can't afford to lose contact with the enemy, as the phrase goes, and not literal enemy, but with Russia. I think it's important to keep talking. It's frustrating, and I'm a little worried there isn't enough strategic, just because these guys can think the wackiest things if you don't stay in contact with them. They really, and those of you who've seen Russians and they've told you what their intelligence services have told them about what's going on. And so, I mean, it's wild. And so it's not safe to let that just run amok. So you asked me about the INF Treaty, and I'm sorry if this is an unpopular point of view, because I know a lot of people would like to not see the INF Treaty go away. But my view always on the INF Treaty was, as Secretary of Defense, I don't want it more than they do. Mm-hmm. Because I was always looking on the other side of the fence at short-range missiles, which we weren't allowed to have, which I could think of lots of uses for in Europe and in Asia. And remember, the Chinese are getting ready to fire them at us all the time. And we don't have anything to fire back because we're in some deal with the Russians. And that doesn't mean I'm for tearing it all up. And I don't want to walk, but you can't forget that they actually did violate it. Number one, they don't want it either, really. But number two, I know what to do if I'm given that latitude, and I assume my successor's successor will know what to do as well. And so from that point of view, from the military point of view, not the political point of view, it's not so bad. We could make good use of what we call conventional prompt strike.
Mm-hmm. So you think this is designed to do away, potentially, with some of these arms control agreements? Because you're setting up an impossible round of three-way talks?
Yeah, I guess so. I think so. I think it is something that sounds good and sounds, wow, that's take the big three biggest powers, get them all in the room, and so the gullible will bite on that hook. I don't think there's anything really there. And in the meantime, you do away with something that did take 30, 40 years to build. Just in general, things take so long to make in the real world. Mm-hmm. And it's so easy to take them apart that I'm not just conservative or anything by nature. I mean, naturally conservative by nature or anything, but I'm always suspicious when something that's been around for a while is getting dismantled. And that doesn't mean I'm not ready to charge into the future. You know, I'm a scientist, I'm a technologist, future, I'm all about that. It was very big for me in the Defense Department. But I didn't take apart things readily. I'm happy to build new things, but taking apart things is, unless you really, really have a replacement, not a phony replacement, that's risky, and things take so long to build. You can do a lot of destruction in no time in Washington, and I'm a builder. I like builders. A lot of builders I see out here in the audience. That takes a lot of patience, and the people who take stuff apart are, you can do that on the cheap. So I'm a little suspicious about that.
Well, along those lines, the Iran nuclear deal. Hmm. As you look at what's happening right now with the potential unraveling of this international diplomatic agreement, when does the flashing yellow light turn red for you? What do you think is actually happening right now?
On the nuclear front, I'm less concerned, perhaps, than people might think, for the following reason. The JCPO, and I'll come back to that and what it meant and didn't mean from the start.
The nuclear accord.
The nuclear deal. But what it did, Margaret, as you well know, is it forced the Iranians in the early years, and they may regret this now, before we could leave it, to destroy a lot of their stuff.
Right.
They had to ruin their Iraq reactor and a bunch of, and we're still kind of getting the benefits of that. So they're putting their toe in the water now with this little bit of enrichment thing. But they've got a ways to go to get back to even where they were, let alone to getting forward to a bomb. So a little bit of room.
Still there. About a year, right, was the projection at the time of the
Yeah, and that was under very in a very determined circumstance where they were starting with what they had then, which is not what they have now.
So there's more than a year out from actually being anywhere near.
Yeah, it's always hard to call this 1 year thing, but the fact of the matter is that in the early years of the agreement, they had to hobble themselves,
right.
And that's nice that we're now enjoying that fact. And that's a good thing. Plus, they seem to be just putting their toe in the water because they don't want to get the Chinese, the Russians, and the Europeans on their backs. So we all have that going for us. What worries me in the U.S.-China thing is less that, and not that we're going to go to war with one another, because our president says he doesn't want war, and he said that consistently and repeatedly. Whatever anybody else has said in the government, he has said that. And the Iranians, I don't think, are in any position to want war. You know, mm-hmm. well, that area better than I do, so you may have a view on this too, Margaret, but I don't think they're in a position, certainly not in a position of military strength, but they're not in a position of international or domestic political strength to take something like that on. So it's not intentional war either. What is the risk in the U.S.-Iranian situation today is something unintentional. We're up against each other so close there, mm-hmm. in the Gulf and the Strait of Hormuz, and there isn't enough of an anchor to if something flares up. Now, I happen to have been in office when 10 U.S. sailors were detained by the Iranians. For reasons that happened to be us going into their territorial waters without navigating properly, put it bluntly.
And this was in the middle of the negotiations.
There's no better time in terms of, comparatively speaking. You're in the middle of a very visible negotiation. It's not like a time where we're trading insults or not talking at all. But it's American hostages. So imagine what we're doing in the Defense Department. In the early days, Peter Cook here remembers this very well. We're spooling up really fast. Self-defense is a big deal. Taking Americans, Iranians taking Americans, detaining Americans, wow. So the blood is getting up really fast, and we're spinning up really fast. And fortunately, John Kerry could call somebody on a cell phone and at least get some adult leadership and get this thing kind of settled down real quickly before we could get at each other. That kind of thing, which is possible every day, because, some sailor blundered and we took his little boats into Iranian territorial waters. These things are possible on our side or on the Iranian side, but there's no counterweight now. Where's that phone call going to come from? How's that going to get resolved? And that's an ugly baby within one day. Mm-hmm. Because everybody remembers the Iranian hostage drama, and so that's what bothers me more than intentional war or the nuclear thing right now. The thing I worry about more every day with the United States and Iran is that we there's a spark somewhere and the grass is so dry.
I want to ask you, China, North Korea as well. On North Korea, when you left the administration, did you feel it was just unfinished business? How frustrated were you of the capabilities Kim was left with?
You got to be frustrated with the North Koreans, but I had been dealing with them since the early 90s. And so I, the grandfather, the father, this guy, all progressively getting worse. And
there had been attempts at diplomatic outreach.
There had been, and there have been little bits of progress here and there. 1994, there was some. 1998, there was some. 2006, after they exploded their first bomb, Condi Rice and Colin Powell gave it a try. And I have to say, and I was part of those in the past, particularly the first two, but also the third one as well, the six-party talks. The Obama administration didn't try, basically. I think President Obama, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but my inference was that he didn't think it would go anywhere. And what he did, which I was grateful for, and was back me up and my immediate predecessor. So if you don't have talks, all you have, not all you have, but what you have to do is, as see Vince Brooks here, is deterrence and defense. And so we did deterrence and defense. And deterrence means having forces, ours and our OK forces, that are so obviously capable of destroying the North Korean armed forces and destroying the North Korean regime that they can't possibly imagine that they won't lose a war if one starts. And defense is our missile defenses. And you remember, that was controversial. When I was undersecretary, the weapons czars are called, and was doing missile defenses in Alaska and California, people were saying, well, you're going to anger the Russians, or they don't work, and why are you doing this? And my standard answer, and I think it was the government's standard answer at the time, was somebody, the North Koreans or the Iranians, is going to get there someday on the path they're on. And I don't want to be defenseless when that happens. And so we did build and deploy. And so we're not defenseless. So at any rate, deterrence and defense. We didn't talk to him. I don't object to talking to him now. I can't tell you I exactly get what's going on. All the presidents that I observed deal with North Korea, starting with Bush 1, refused to meet with a North Korean leader unless and until an agreement was all sewn up. Mm-hmm. Because they knew that to meet, for an American leader to meet with the North Korean leader was a gift to the North Koreans. I mean, they crave that. And if you're in a negotiation with somebody, you don't give anything for free.
But the administration would argue all the past attempts had failed. So why not try?
But that doesn't
something
mean you
totally
give away something. I mean, this is a tactical point. You don't give away something for free. Mm-hmm. You don't give away something that somebody else values for free. So it's just not, I mean, to me, it's just not negotiating to give away something for free. It's okay if you want to have a meeting, you want to have a range of, I mean, with the North Koreans, everything is a transaction. So, and Koreans in general are like that. And so so I'm all for dealing with them. You say, you do this, I'll do that. And then if that works out, then I'll do this and you do that. And that's how everything has to progress. But I wouldn't give them a meeting. I wouldn't advise the president to give them a meeting. I might advise them to trade a meeting, but not give a meeting.
Is containment ultimately where this ends up? Not a North Korea giving up its nuclear weapons, but just putting some constraints
on
it?
It'll be a heavy lift, and that's not the path we seem to be on. We say we're on it, but you don't see that tracks being laid down. If that is possible, you got to do something different from what we're doing. I'm not sure it is possible. And the more they get dug into being treated like it's a fait accompli, the harder it would be to dislodge them. And so 2006, okay, it's 2019 now. 13 years ago, they exploded their first bomb. That's a lot of cement around the ankles for these guys. And then on top of that, they're getting meetings and people are talking about kind of lesser things like family meetings and returning remains and so forth, which are important, but which are a far cry from denuclearizing, or even test moratoria and so forth, which are useful, but that's not denuclearizing the Korean Peninsula. And Mari, you know, and other people in this room know, That's not a new pledge either. The North Koreans promised that to George Bush 1 in 1992. So we didn't get a new promise. They just never lived up to the promise.
I want to go to questions in the audience, but before we do that, you hear a lot about questions regarding Chinese telecom firms, particularly Huawei, and the level of access that they should have to this market, and in exchange also American businesses doing, conducting business with those firms. Should American companies be allowed to do business with Huawei?
Sometimes not.
Given that you could make the argument they are complicit in the surveillance.
Right. That's exactly the reason. And I don't want to sound harsh about, but you know, China hasn't worked out the way we hoped in the 1990s. The economists, and I came to that conclusion about the year 2000. I've dealt with the PLA for a quarter century, many of you have. As well, and you know, in the 1990s, it was possible to hope that China would become a big France. And you couldn't believe that by 2000, and you certainly can't believe it by now. Now, I don't think that that doesn't mean we're going to have World War III with them or a Cold War with them. But you have to ask yourself, what does that mean? That China is what China is, particularly in the economic and technological area, Margaret, I don't think the economists have given us a playbook for that. And so you see in the, for example, the tariff negotiations, that's a start. It's a groping towards that playbook. But I don't think anybody can believe tariffs is the whole of the playbook. It's like a chapter of the playbook, but it's not the entirety of the playbook.
But blacklisting Huawei is something you do support.
Yes. There are various shades and so forth of that. And you can't do everything, like their handsets, as against their installed 5G equipment. Huawei's a big thing, does lots of things, so I don't want to... Right. Yeah, I'm in favor of we got to stick up for ourselves. China is a communist dictatorship, and I'm not out to change them, but when they come to the business scene, they bring a combination of political, military, and economic tools that our societies like ours don't possess. And we need to protect our companies and protect our friends and allies against what is inherently an uneven playing field. I think our companies reasonably expect our government to do that for them, and not to say that we have two playbooks. We have a Cold War playbook, which is CFIUS and export controls and all that, which it was for a communist dictatorship that we didn't trade with, so that doesn't work, or free trade, big France. Neither of those is right. We need a playbook for this situation. You see that being acted out in Huawei, in this question of whether students who are paid for by the U.S. government who are Chinese and then go back to China, whether is that an okay thing or not? These are real questions. I have some frustration with the international economic thinking. I'm not an economist. I'm not going to say I would do better all by myself, but my disappointment is very real in that area.
Plenty more to ask you, but I want to open it up to questions from the audience, from the members here today. And just to remind you, you are on the record. So we do have microphones on the sides of the room if you want to raise your hand. When you take the microphone, please say your name and your affiliation. And just one question, please, and a question. Not a speech. Here in front.
John Holden with McLarty Associates. Following on the 5G issue, should the United States, as a matter of priority, develop 6G and leapfrog this technology if it's going to be the backbone of the next industrial revolution?
Well, in general, the answer to that question, John, is yes. We should be looking to leapfrog. You got to be a little careful with 5G. 5G's become this big god. And I was around when cellular was first invented, and remember when we walked around in the nuclear command and control area with this huge thing that was a tiny in capability compared to the thing that fits in your pocket now. We would carry them around like this. So it's come a long way, and cellular was a hard thing to put together. But you know, 5G isn't magic. It's like it's 4G only sort of smaller. A little bit takes care of the latency business, increases the bandwidth. It's not like the end of the world. And you've got to do a lot of installation of this stuff because they've got to be much closer together. Mm-hmm. And so there are going to be hassles with buildings and walls, and which are, because this doesn't bend around curves nearly because it's higher frequency. So 5G isn't like hugely wonderful. And I don't even know what 6G, what people mean by 60. At some point you got to get on a wire line or get really close to a transceiver if you're going to get like super wide bandwidth. So this is kind of a big engineering deployment project. It's not wildly sophisticated. I don't think it's going to be transformative for the experience people have, but it's a step up better, but it requires a whole hell of a lot of leasing of mm-hmm. antenna space on buildings and that kind of thing. And on the whole, I would rather have all that work done and all that infrastructure bought from an American company or a company I trust more than Huawei. That's fine. But John, your general question about leapfrogging gets me to another point, if I may, just take the time to make, which is I've been talking about things like Huawei, which is a defensive play. Mm-hmm. Respect to China, we need an offense. You can't just play defense. You got to have an offense, which means we have to be better. And I think that's what's underlying John's question here. So if you're worried about Chinese and AI, let's beat them in AI, and rather than hobble them in AI, which we probably don't know how to do very well. So there's no, it's the old Sputnik thing. You know, there's no substitute for just being better. And getting there faster and so forth. And we shouldn't take sight of all, take our eyes off of that. At the same time, we're trying to not be unfairly beaten where a communist dictatorship has tools that we don't.
Okay. I'll come back to you here. Can we try this side of the room? Here, I think Cynthia. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Cynthia Roberts, I'm a CFR fellow at the Joint Staff this year.
Okay.
So, and my question's just my question, not theirs. Given what you've said about Putin in Russia, and given you've also said that it's a sobering fact in your view that the problem of nuclear Armageddon is less pressing than perhaps Russia using a limited strike to end a fait accompli where they tried to push us out and NATO out of Europe in terms of defending an ally or a partner. So my question is about the responses that you favor, and would they be, you've talked about missiles, you've talked about missile defense, and you've talked about nuclear weapons. So would you prefer conventional missiles, and then would our European allies accept those as a post-INF? Mm-hmm. Would you prefer a kind of low yield nuclear option? And finally, on the missile defense, we've told the Russians and Putin for years that we wanted missile defense not against Russia, but against, you know, an Iran threat or something like Iran. Would we now change our mind and say to him, too bad, this is your problem, or not? Thank you.
Okay. All good questions. You got a bunch of things embedded in there. But first of all, before we get to all the little new little gizmos and so forth at the end of your question, most of my answer to what do we do about Russia, there are a few factors to it, and we got to be a little careful what we say here. One is, it's a big country. I wouldn't like to be defending that country. And so part of my answer to Vladimir Putin is, you know, you may think that the war's here, but pal, I'm global. So you show up in Tallinn, I'll show up in Vladivostok, so to speak. And so I, that's part, I'm saying more than that, but part of my answer. Another part of my answer is, you know, we got to play this hybrid game better. Mm-hmm. And call it
when the little green men.
Yes, the little green men, or the goosing around with cyber and pretending it's not an attack. To me, an attack is an attack. So a lot of my answer doesn't get to, but you ask about a number of things. INF missiles, yeah, I mean, as I said, I'm kind of, they have their attractions to a Secretary of Defense. And, you know, we gave them up and we thought we got a deal once upon a time. If I'm not going to have that constraint anymore, I certainly know what to do with it. And Russia's part of that. I think it's a little more useful with respect to China, if I may say so. Mini nukes is a big debate going on now. The only thing I'll say about that is, I mean, is a couple of things. First, no nuclear weapons are really small. But the second is, I mean, nobody can want to use more yield than they have to. I think what bothers people most is the idea that somehow this makes weapons more doable or more usable. I don't find that plausible. I don't think grown-up, responsible people who are think about nuclear weapons or, God forbid, would ever use nuclear weapons would be a major, and they'd say, well, it's just, you know, a few kilotons, it's not a 500 kilotons. I don't think that would really swing it. So a lot of these things are exotic and people are looking for some silver bullet and says, oh, if only we can violate the INF treaty, we'll be able to take care of the Russians, or we'll goose around with the nuclear weapons, we'll take care of the Russians. I think it's more comprehensive than that. And there are other ingredients to the wartime approach and again, remember, I don't want a war with Russia. I'm only saying that makes them convinced in detail that they will lose. And by the way, missile defenses, forget it with respect to Russia. They got too much stuff. I mean, we can hold our own with the North Koreans for a number of years at least, but the Russians just have too much stuff. And but again, they come at you again and again and again complaining about missile defense. And I've been having these conversations. Senator Warner's here. He's been having these conversations too for 30, 40 years. And you go, you know, if I knew how to defend myself from you, I would. But I don't. We haven't known how to do that since Star Wars or any of these other things. And it's not that we haven't tried. They have too much stuff.
Kimberly Dozier here.
Thank you. Kim Dozier, Daily Beast. Continuing on the theme of alliances, has the transactional nature of this administration so far caused any sort of damage that can't be spooled back, something permanent that a future Democrat or Republican alliance-minded organization couldn't fix? I mean, you do have Ambassador Bolton, who is fairly pro-NATO in their name.
Yeah. Let's just sort of back up some. Why do we have alliances and partnerships anyway? These aren't favors we do for foreigners. This is a force multiplier for us. And people who reflect our values and our interests enough that they might fight alongside of us. And having somebody fight alongside of you is better than doing it by yourself. And you can't do that transactionally. It's like a family or something. There are transactions or a marriage. There are transactions within a marriage, but there has to be an underlying relationship as well, particularly among democracies. And you ask, after you've called into question a alliance, how easy it is it to get it back in a solid ground. I think what's going to make that tricky, where we have done that, is these are democracies. So you're not dealing just with the leader. And the thing about a democracy is once you've ticked its people off, or they have felt disrespected, no leader they elect can ever lead them in the right direction, even if it is the right direction, because they can't get away with it, because the people don't want it. So it's, if you're dealing with Vladimir Putin, you can take him this way and then that way, and he'd never mind his people, and Xi Jinping. But if you're trying to deal with a Theresa May or whatever, she can't zig and zag like that because she's got an opinion of her own to pay attention to. So it is a relationship with another people if it's a democracy. And that inevitably makes it something you can't dial up and down and do in a transactional way. People want to feel connected. And, you know, look, I believe in the values thing. I believe in the values of the Enlightenment. And I don't have it. The Chinese are fine with me, but I'm not Chinese. And the Enlightenment and our values are about, you know, what they called the dignity of man, but would now be dignity of humankind, and was at least in theory, I know sometimes we can be very American and so forth, but universal. It was about human rights and human, and that's kind of where I am as a person. And China's ideology about being Chinese, which is fine if you're Chinese. But since I'm not, it's not, you know, hugely attractive. And so you look at the globe and you say, where are there people who kind of share our values? It's more than just interests and history and so forth. It's kind of values as well. And that it matters to me, and it's worth having a relationship with people who share your values in international life, even as it is in ordinary human life.
But you wouldn't go as far as, say, Joe Biden, who worried out loud the other day about NATO not surviving a second term of a Trump presidency.
I didn't hear him say that. I didn't hear him say.
It's a CNN interview.
So, okay, I'm sorry. That shows you how little I have to do with maybe Senator Warner heard. I don't believe that if he did say that, only because I think it is a relation. I think there's more ballast in this system than people know. I just think people have sense, and they know that we in the United Kingdom are friends and are going to be friends for a long time. When I worked for Weinberger a long time ago, and this was secret then, but we were helping the Brits in the Falklands. Mm-hmm. And there was no reason for that, in the sense that we didn't have any stake in the Falklands. We did it because we were friends of Great Britain, which, by the way, we used to be an enemy of. I mean, you have to go back to the Revolution. No, we were an enemy in between World War I and World War II, in a sense, if you read the newspapers. Mm-hmm. And we only became big pals in World War II, but pals we are. And so we helped them out when they were in a rough spot. And that's a perfectly valid thing to do. And these countries are going to look at the globe, just like we look at the globe, and say, where are some people we can get along with? Mm-hmm. And there aren't a whole lot of them. And the Europeans are one of them, and the Canadians, not the only ones. We have the Japanese and the Australians, and South Korea, and there are lots of people. But these are people who are friends for a reason.
Okay, on this side of the room. Gentleman there, I can't see your name tag, but if you could introduce yourself.
Greg Tillman, I'm a board member of the Arms Control Association. You said that you can think of a lot of uses of conventionally armed INF missiles. Since the INF treaty had no limits on air-launched and sea-launched INF range missiles, could you elaborate a little bit on the uses or on the need for having land-based systems, particularly considering the fact that, can you also imagine a lot of countries that would welcome U.S. INF range missiles to be hosted on their territory?
No, I don't want to elaborate too much, but you're right. We were allowed to do some things, but if you go around the Asia Pacific, and you want to be able to get somewhere quickly and land to land, there are some attractive circumstances for the United States. It's not going to. It's not transformative, otherwise we may have gotten out of the INF treaty earlier. I'm just saying, if you release me from the constraints, it's not like I don't have anything, I don't can't think of anything to do.
Okay, here on this side of the room. Senator, here.
Ash, nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, Senator.
By the way, what sort of pills are you taking to maintain the shape you're in?
I was going to ask you.
No, yeah. I periodically go back to primarily Quantico, Virginia, because my modest military career there started at the end of World War II. And they were so proud. The guys were there. They walked me through the barracks. They looked the same. Their rucksacks were all packed, rifles slung, M1's gone, another rifle now. And they're ready to go. They're so proud that they could respond within 3 hours, be ready for a forward deployment. That's not the war, Ash, that worries me. It's a cybersecurity war. Mm-hmm. How do we know when we're in one of those things? What shape is it going to take? And how well prepared are we from that youngster down there in the Marine Corps, that second lieutenant is ready to go? And what's his role, if any?
Good. Well, you're so right. And I'll tell you, to me, what it looks like is a cybersecurity attack looks like an attack, to Ash Carter. I get this question all the time. I don't care whether it's cyber or not. If you attack my people, you attack my country.
Is that taking out a power grid, or is that
hacking
emails?
Well, for example, a power grid is destructive and threatening to my people. So
hacking the DNC.
You're more in a difficult territory. It is an attack, but it's not like an all-out military attack. But it is an attack. You have to say that is aggression in my country. What am I going to do to punish and push back? So the first thing is an attack is an attack. Are the Marines part of a possible response to that? Yeah, because I wouldn't necessarily respond to a cyber attack with a cyber response. Why should I? When people flew airplanes into our buildings, we didn't fly airplanes into their buildings. So you do something to me and my people, and I'm going to do whatever I damn well want. And that seems efficacious. And that might be the United States Marine Corps. It might not be a cyber response. So it does need to be gradated, depending upon what's the DNC or an infrastructure attack. So proportionality and discrimination are still important in cyber. But you don't have to do cyber for cyber. You need to be able to call something for what it is and not get befuddled by the fact that they happen to be using bits.
Did you recognize the hacking of the DNC as an attack at that time?
I did. It's an aggressive, overtly aggressive act against our political system. And by the way, by a guy who lives in a glass house, who's throwing domestic political stones.
But do you know it instantaneously? Because there's the argument, it would take time,
that.
You have to investigate, remember, you may not know
I wouldn't
attack.
Say I did, and it's not because I'm, remember that we weren't really part of that in the normal course of things. That was more a law enforcement and a domestic thing, I see the judge here. Quite appropriately, the Department of Defense is not normally So I probably can't tell you everything that was going on or that we knew was going on, simply because I was the Secretary of Defense, and it would not be normal if Jim Comey or John Brennan or one of those people was here, they could probably tell you more. And actually, by the way, if I may say so, there's a good side to that, which is President Obama was always very careful, and everybody in my observation, all the years I've been associated with defense, has always been very careful to keep the Defense Department out of politics. And so it was considered we shouldn't invite those guys for a conversation about what we're going to do about the election act. Because obviously that's a political conversation. We're in the middle of an election campaign, so how you deal with it could affect the outcome of the election itself. And so if you're in a position of responsibility, you have to ask yourself, is it appropriate for me to do something? I'm sure there were conversations like that going on, but we weren't, Joe Dunford and I weren't part of them because we wouldn't normally be invited to them, and that's okay with me. But in the intelligence briefing sense, I knew what what the Russians were doing. It didn't surprise me at all, and I didn't require a whole lot of convincing. And it was irrefutable by the time, you know, fall came. I don't see how you could possibly think that they weren't doing it, weren't doing it deliberately.
Here in the aisle, the gentleman midway through in the blue shirt.
Thanks. Jeremy Young, I'm a journalist with Al Jazeera. Following up on your comment about keeping the Department of Defense out of politics, I was wondering if you can share with us your thoughts on President Trump's 4th of July Salute to America event on the Mall. What was your thoughts and takeaways on it?
Well, I guess one answer is to say I'd prefer to call it a 4th of July celebration, not belonging to anybody. In general, the troops are supposed to be training for war. And that's what they should be doing. Every holiday has its purpose. We have Veterans Day and Memorial Day, which are particularly important to us in the Department of Defense. And they're the days that we particularly honor our institution. There are inauguration days when we honor presidents. There are 4th of July's where we're honoring the principles that created the nation in which we live. So different holidays have different purposes. But I think one way of answering your question is the troops are supposed to be training for war. That's what we need them to be doing, first and foremost, whatever else they're doing.
So I imagine you don't like the border deployments either.
I don't like
the U.S. border deployments.
No, I mean, they're not trained for that. They're not authorized for that. We have tens of thousands of people in our Customs and Border Patrol. You know, we have forces that do that are trained to do that. Remember, our guys aren't trained to do that. And they're trained for war, which is what we want them be trained. They're not trained to do that. And they're also not authorized to do it. In other words, they don't have the law enforcement abilities. So they're not the right force to be using there. We have the right force. If it needs to be bigger, let's make it bigger. But our guys are not trained to do that, and they're not authorized to do that. So.
On this side, the gentleman with the glasses in the back there, in the middle.
Thanks for this opportunity. My name is Pinran from China Xinhua News Agency. So there was an article on Washington Post last week, which signed by 100 U.S. scholars, disagreeing with the current administration's China policy and arguing that China is not an enemy of the United States. So what's your point of this article? And do you see China as an enemy of the United States? And do you endorse the Trump administration's China policy, especially in the security room? Thank you.
Okay, so you've got, is China an enemy? Do I endorse the Trump policy, and do I endorse the letter? First of all, the question is, China an enemy? China is a competitor, a geostrategic opponent. Enemy boils the thing down to, I don't want to be an enemy of China. I know who would win a war with China. No one in their right mind can possibly, that is us, can want to have a war with China. I think on to the expression of the scholars, I read that and respectfully read it. And it has some good points in there. In general, I don't buy the American creation story of the U.S.-China competition. There's one version of that, which is actually by a very good friend of mine and wonderful colleague who wrote a really interesting book called Thucydides' Trap, Graham Allison. But remember, Thucydides' formulation was that the war was caused by the rise of one power and the fear that caused in the other. That was Thucydides' famous historical judgment. I don't think that quite works in this case. I don't see the United States fear as contributing to. By the way, don't forget, in the case of the Peloponnesian War, despite the trap of Thucydides, they did go to war, and you know who won? The U.S. side. So the historical analogy doesn't get you where you want it to go if these letter writers are in that camp. So I don't think we're causing things. At the same time, I don't put the whole thing on the China as well. With respect to the Trump administration's policy, which is your other question, I don't know exactly what it is because. It has the trade dimension. Well, I just mean that. It has the trade dimension, which I've talked to, where it seems to me we have tariffs, which I get. I understand that. And that is a tool. But it seems to me one instrument and not an orchestra. I don't chalk that all up to the Trump administration because I don't think, as I said, that we've gotten from our international economic policymakers a full playbook. And I think there are other pieces. There would be a piece that dealt with the Huawei dilemma. There would be, there would be other things than tariffs in it. I think to the extent it is reflective of this country coming to the view that we need to have a more intentional politico-economic policy with respect to China, I think that is necessary and inevitable and actually long overdue. But I still think, I see us still scratching for a playbook, which is intrinsically hard if in a country like ours because we can't just decide this is the playbook like you can do in China. And Xi Jinping says that's the playbook. It's not going to be that easy the way we run our country.
Well, I see all these hands, and I know I have more questions, but I do have to keep us to time to get us wrapped up by 1:30. So I want to thank all of you members for coming today and for Secretary Carter for your time and your conversation.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Thank you. That was fun.